Wake up, Atlanta. It's your favorite radio family, the Genius. And guess what?
What?
They're back.
Garrett and Jocelyn.
Along with their amazing entrepreneur daughters, Brittany and Nicole, covering everything.
I mean everything.
From relationships, family, music, and business.
And guess who else is here?
Who? The Maestro and Classy J are here to keep it real and inspire you
just a little bit more.
Each Monday, while Brittany and Nicole,
hold on, did you say Brittany and Nicole, Shawty?
Bring you the latest in pop culture
and exclusive interviews.
So don't touch that computer. Live, here's this week's episode of The Family Empire.
I got hot sauce in my bag, swag. Guys, it's Classy J coming to you today with the radio conversation and questions of the day. You know how we feel about these questions. It's like that great combo for dinner. It's horrible when you're at the dinner table and there's nothing good to talk about. So I have two questions for you today. And those two questions are, the first one is about moms. And of course, you know, I'm a mom. And I want to know, what is the worst fight that you've ever had with your mother, and what was it about? Now, this should be pretty interesting today, because who knows what my daughters are gonna say. I have three lovely daughters, but oh my God, I am almost feeling like I probably shouldn't put this question out here, but I am, and I want you to be vulnerable too and answer this question. Now, for me, I would say the worst fight that my mom and I had was I was waiting on a check that came to her residence, and she kept telling me it hadn't arrived. And you guys, like, you would literally have to know my mom to really get this, but she was kind of a nonchalant kind of, well, you know, she was, how could I say it, she didn't care about your feelings if she was, you know. And but anyway, she kept saying no, hadn't come. So finally I was like, okay, let me call the people who issued the check. And I was telling her about it and how they said that the check had been cashed, and I was gonna, you know, file a report. And then she finally tells me she was the one to cash the check. Guys, can you believe that? After I had been waiting on this check. And the thing about my mom, I would give her things. I could have given her the check if I knew she really needed it. But I asked her, Mom, how in the world did you cash a check with my name on it? She said, well, I have friends in high places. I said, so, you know somebody at the bank? No, but I know someone who owns a daycare center. And I just signed your name on the back of the check, and she cashed it for me because she knows me. Guys, I was livid. And let me tell you what she was doing while she was telling me this. On her sewing machine, sewing. I cashed it. Like it was nothing, okay? Now, I'm sure my story might be worse than that, so I'm not going to judge my mom harshly here. But make sure you talk to us. Let us know what you think about that. The second thing is, what is the thing that you have talked to your spouse about over and over and over, and they constantly still do it, and it drives you crazy? Now listen, I got a whole list of those things. Look, if y'all have the ears, I have the time, okay? But just for producer's sake today, right, I better keep this short. So I would say, hopefully the producer will let me come back and talk about a few more things. But the first thing, probably the most annoying thing, one of the most annoying things, is we have an agreement that he gets the remote and I get the light for the room. Mainly because he watches more TV and I usually need the light for more things like reading or working on things, you know? So I am always having to ask him for the light remote. Always having to ask him for the light remote. That drives me crazy, because when I get ready to turn on that light, I do not want to get out of the bed. It's a light remote. I want to just be able to flick on the light, and I can't. So that really disturbs me. And I've said a billion times, please, you keep the remote, I keep the light switch. But again, hopefully I'll be able to come back and share some more annoying things about Garrick, okay? But hey, listen, make sure you answer those questions, and wherever you've tuned in today in the show, whether it's the beginning, the middle, or at the end, you'll hear this question. So make sure you go ahead and answer it right down there in the box. And hopefully next time we'll get a chance to read some of those, okay? I love doing that, all right? Guys, have a great one.
Hey guys, it's Rihanna Nicole.
Joycelyn.
We're here with your strange things. Let's get straight into it. Okay, so I've always thought it was super strange how a robber could just walk in or out of a bank so casually with hundreds of thousands up to millions of dollars.
But that's what they do. It's their profession.
It's true.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened in 1969 at the Society National Bank. It happened in Cleveland. His name was Theodore John Conrad. He was 20 years old and he worked as a bank teller. And what did he do one Friday when he got off work? Well, he just scooped $215,000 into a plastic bag and walked right out the door. Thing is, he had told friends, hey, I'm going to rob the bank today. They just didn't think he was going to do it. And the police or the bank didn't realize the money was missing until that Monday. I guess things were different back then, but that's how long it took them to figure it out. And by that point, Theodore had a 2-day head start, and he was off creating a new alias and starting a new life where he would live for the next 50 years in the suburbs with a wife and children until he died earlier this year in 2021 of lung cancer. They just identified him as the suspect in this crime last month, November 2021.
Wow, that is crazy.
Yeah. And if you're wondering, $215,000 in 1969 money, well, that's equivalent to about $1.7 million.
I would love to interview his wife once she found out what, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that would be a great interview.
Yeah, yeah.
What's next, Nicole?
Well, New Zealand. I just feel like they are that country that has, like, all the stuff every other country would never think to have, but once you find out, it's like, dang it, we need a talking giraffe at all of our airports, you know? Well, one thing they're doing without now is their wizard. They had an official wizard that was actually on salary.
That's cool and weird at the same time,
right? Yeah, an official wizard, and he was on salary. He was making about $16,000 New Zealand money, $11,000 American money. Wow. It's not a lot, but I don't think his duties really carried for that much. Well, they said that his comments on recent government tourist plans and women, that's what caused him to lose a job.
Oh, the wizard wasn't wise.
Wizard was not wise. So if you're a wizard out there and you're looking for some easy pay, New Zealand, I believe they have free healthcare. No, doesn't he? Yeah, they got free healthcare. That, so listen.
That's worth it alone.
11,000 seems like it's not a lot. That is a lot, okay?
You're and never, that's a good reason to keep your job.
Right? Just go for it. Just go. Just do it, okay? Another thing I've always said that I wanted to do is sleeping inside of an IKEA overnight. Like, I just feel like it's like, because who doesn't want to sleep in a Walmart overnight, right? Right? But this is like the bougie version of Walmart. It's IKEA. Like, you know?
No way. I could never sleep in an IKEA.
Take all the pictures. Like, look at my new bed set. You know, like super flex for the gram.
Well, I could never sleep in any store like that open at night.
I'm all about adventures.
Even if it was Cantoni. I'm sorry. I can't do it.
Let's do it. So, yeah, snowstorm in Denmark pushed 6,006 customers and about 24 employees to sleep overnight inside the store. And they, of course, let them sleep in the beds that are out for display.
Ooh, girls, and, really can't sleep. First, we got to change the mattresses, new mattresses, and we have to put down new bedding. If I'm to sleep. But, you know, sleeping out in the open is, like, creepy. That's like when the ghosts and the goblins and all the other things come out. But when you're safe in your room with the door locked, you know, it's just less space for, you know, crazy things to happen.
If you think a shut door is going to keep a ghost from hunting you, then you probably deserve to be haunted.
No, but it welcomes them the more because the atmosphere is not conducive for just what you declared it to be, which is sleep.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're in an open atmosphere, that's very hard to do because it's kind of like being in your home and being outside.
Uh-huh.
Y'all get it?
Uh-uh.
Okay, anyway.
Because I would sleep outside.
Well, yeah, but then when you sleep outside, though, there are a lot of things that can go wrong as opposed to if you're inside. Mm-mm. Yeah. Yeah, like it's more open to threats when you're outside. That's just a common thing. You're outside, you're more open to threats. You're more prone for, you know, the things.
We need 10 people to go test this theory out and go sleep outside tonight. Okay.
Or somebody call IKEA so Brianna can go have an overnight party.
Woo-hoo. Well, let's talk. Speaking of partying, Behan Mutlu, he lives in Turkey, Northwest Turkey. He was out with his friends drinking and got a little too drunk, had a little fun. Okay, who doesn't like a good night with friends? And after a few hours of him, the friends and the wife not being able to locate him because he wandered away drunk, they reported him missing. Now, here's the interesting part. I want to know, like, what is the law over there? Because, you know, in America, you got to be missing for 24 hours. Like, you know, they're not just going to even, you know. Well, anyways, they start up some search parties. The local police are looking for him. He joins in on the search. He sees this crowd of people looking for somebody. He's like, I'm going to go help and be a good citizen. And it's when they start calling his name that he answers.
Well, I don't even think he... Well, okay, keep going. I'm sorry.
It's when they call his name that he drunkenly answers, I'm here. I'm over here.
I don't even think
And the police are like, wait, what?
I think he was so drunk, he didn't even know what was happening. He just went where the people were going.
It's like, it's a party round number two. And after questioning him for a few hours, the police were like, all right, you're
So just, he shows up to his own search and then says, I'm here. Yeah, totally wasted.
Yeah. And so the police drove him home. And I'm sure his wife was happy to see him. Or maybe not. I don't know.
Oof.
Mm-mm. Last story of the day, guys. I want to tell you guys about this book that was rented out on November 8th, 1911. Mm. And it was returned 115 years after its checkout date.
Of course not by the same person, right?
No, obviously not by the same person. No, it was actually, they don't know who turned it in, but the librarians found it, and they just thought it was like a book being donated, and then they realized that it had a sticker, the library sticker, and they were like, wait a minute. And it had been checked out for 115 years, and they said that if they were still, you know, applying the late fees that were in place at that time, it'd be about $800 late. Now, here's the thing. $800 is not late on library charge. I'll bring that up in my fourth grade career, okay? So I'm like, really? $800 is not that. That's not that bad. That's not that bad. This was in Idaho. Library in Idaho.
Wow. So, hey, listen, guys. That's a perfect story. Even though it's a strange story, to never, ever give up if you've lost something. Maybe you won't get it in your lifetime, but somebody somewhere else will.
Also, I want to know who returned it, because if you know something about library, you aren't charged until you return it, you know? So it's like, let's say you have a book, right, and you keep it out for 3 weeks. Mm. They're not going to charge you until you bring it back.
Yeah.
So if I found a library book, I'm not taking it back, because it's like, you know, like...
Like, I'm responsible for this.
Well, actually, they wouldn't charge me, they charge the person, so I guess that's why the person turned it in, right?
Yeah. Anyway. Well, listen, guys, thank you for tuning in for one of your favorite segment and our Strange Stories.
Your boy Tobias Cavillion, and you're listening and watching Family Empire.
Hey guys, thanks so much for tuning in. It's Brianna Nicole with Family Empire. We are joined tonight for an exclusive interview with the one and only the Mr. Eric Seitz.
Yes.
He is now joining us live from, where are you from? Where are you from tonight?
I am in Philadelphia.
Philly. Awesome. City of brotherly love.
Yeah, that's where I now reside.
Oh, okay. Wow. Okay. So, and you were actually born and raised in Indianapolis, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So you're on the East Coast now.
I am on the East Coast.
Okay. So I've been to Philly and I've been to Indianapolis. Kind of polar opposites, at least the parts that I went to. So how is that adjusted?
lived in California for the bulk of my life, so that's an adjustment coming from the West Coast to the East.
Right.
But I'm used to bouncing around, so as I don't really consider it to be it. I can accept the changes that come along with the coast.
Okay, and actually, now that I think about it, you correct me if I'm wrong, but when you and Rapture signed with Timbaland, you guys lived in New York for a while, right?
I'm sorry, what was that last part of the question?
When you and Rapture signed with Timbaland, you guys lived in New York for a while, right? Didn't you guys move to New York for a little bit?
We did.
Okay, so was that your actual first time moving to the East Coast?
Yeah, well, Indianapolis is Midwest, so from California, yeah, complete that far to the east. Yes, that was the first time.
Okay.
Yeah. So yes, that's that.
You're not newbie. You're kind of used to it. Like I said, by now. Mm-hmm. Okay. Cool. So last time we spoke to you was about 3 years ago. So much has changed, even in just the past year. I want to know, how has COVID affected your work process, if any at all? I feel like the producers have it a little bit better than those who aren't, you know, diverse that way, because you guys can work. You guys are extremely well at working at home or having your setup, your laptop. So what has that process been like for you with COVID?
For me, COVID allowed me to get some certain things done that I probably had on the back burner. Not necessarily procrastinating about it, but being busy with other things physically. So it allowed me to be still for a second and to start chiseling away at those different ideas and projects that I had in mind that I couldn't entertain because of moving around so much. So I don't have any complaints. I'm blessed to be able to say that I was still able to be productive. And you hit it right on the head when you said from the producer aspect, because I do love traveling and playing as a musician, and I do embrace hibernating in a studio. I don't like one more than the other, so I like the balance that's able to happen when things happen. It's going to always be something, but you know, they used to use cliches like don't put all your eggs in one basket.
Right.
So when COVID hit, you know, with me not only focusing on live musicianship and or production, I was still able to, you know, because I always say everybody's hobby is someone's career. So those other hobbies that I have, you know, you just got to know how to monetize that hobby and make it work for you. And since you're going to be spending time in that arena, you know.
Right. Yeah.
Being resourceful.
Right. Exactly. And I was telling Britt, a few weeks ago, I feel like COVID really weeded out those who say they want it, you know, and those who really, really want it, because, you know, it's one thing to just go and I'm playing here, but it's another thing when the world is shut down and you really got to grind to build that fan base, and you got to get in the studio and really lay it down and really deliver the fans some, you know, what they want. And, make those, not just drop those songs, oh, I'm dropping this for SoundCloud, you know, really make something that's gonna, like you said, be resourceful, you know what I mean? And I feel like COVID definitely did, it did a big weed out on the entertainment industry.
It exposes, and we were able to see firsthand that looking at talk is cheap and seeing is believing, because
right.
It's easy to talk that game, but when you have nothing but time on your hands and you still don't get it done, then that, you know, a lot of people learn something about themselves too, with the absence of what we call normal, not being at the forefront. And then so it exposed us, didn't it? It exposed, it exposed a lot of people's character. And then, so when you look at them after everything is back up and running, it's gonna be hard to hear them the same way, those ones, you know.
Yep.
Like, you had all that time, we still, you know, some people just learn what to say and how to say it, you know.
Right.
But actions speak louder than words. I'm gonna throw a bunch of cliches at y'all, but something about cliches, they're short and sweet, but they're always super fast.
Right.
You know, time exposes us, you know, to, we don't even have to talk about what we're doing. If we look back we have what we call receipts now, or the evidence or the proof of what you've been doing. Time will tell on you. And, you know, so you're either going to be known for being productive or non-effective in, you know.
And you're right, true. And also the fan base, they also are very, you know, like you exactly said, Eric, and I agree with you, man, because of the simple fact that, you know, it was so pre-COVID, everyone was talking about if I had just more, one or two more hours in a day, if I had another day, you know, in the week, you know, to go ahead and do what I can do, you know, I can just get it done. And like you said, what did you do when everything just shut down and all you had was time? So, you know, and you're exactly right, man. So I totally agree with you. And you're right, because the fan base, they can see right through that now. You know, so, hey.
And because now everyone is a musician or everyone is a producer, I feel like the fans aren't so, I won't say gullible, but I feel like before it was kind of like, they would just kind of take the cheap. Now it's like, wait a minute, so much is coming at me. You only give me the best. So I feel like it's making it harder. You know, it's kind of like, okay. It's like a Hunger Games.
Yeah. Right. With every marathon, there starts off with a plethora of people. It's always a boatload of people that start off, but everybody can't finish. Right. And the reason why I use the term marathon is because that's something that's cross country, that's long, that's distance. Right. And so people weed themselves out, you know, no matter what pace they start out. They can start out fast and then be burnt out before the first mile. Then you got those that know how to pace themselves. And then, so what I'm trying to say is that the long run is that, because I mean, if we're going to get to the word, the race is not given to the swift.
Right.
He that endures to the end, end could be a long way away. But your consistency and your pace during that race or marathon is the finish line is going to tell the story.
So true.
I hate to be all like that, you know.
No, but it's so true though, man. You're right on point, man. So hey, you know, I can definitely appreciate you saying that. So you're absolutely right, Britt.
Not only have you been busy in the studio, but also your family life has been having so many announcements this year. Aaron got married in March of this year, correct? Was that March of this year?
Correct.
And now she's just about a week ago, you went live and at the gender reveal, and she's having a baby girl.
Yeah, I'm about to be a grandfather.
Welcome to the club, man.
I know. Isn't it an upgrade?
So that's going to be super exciting.
Yeah.
And then we've been watching Little Miss Gary. Am I pronouncing that correct?
Correct.
Gary. She's been growing up, and I know at her fourth competition, she's doing gymnastics. And at her fourth competition, she actually scored 9.5. Britt and I were gymnasts growing up, so we were very familiar. I was like, okay, very cool.
Don't get scared, Erin. She just does her research.
Hey, I don't get scared of anything that I posted. I know those facts. And it's hard for me not to be a proud parent. That's one thing I believe, but while I have that platform, you know, because one thing about being a young black man, our reputation sometimes is a bad rap when it comes to parenthood.
Right.
And I just like to, you know, expose as much of us as possible in that light, you know.
Right.
And that's the one way that we can control that, you know. We don't have to say what the news says about us. The proof is on your timeline. Right. And I only know a bunch of good dads. It seems like I know more good than bad, so I'm not going to let the propaganda dictate my thoughts towards black men. I know I was raised by a wonderful father, rest in peace, but yes, you know, so yeah, it's, you know, I think it's impossible for us to expose that. You know, I would encourage every father to do as much as he can in that.
And IMDb actually, in their biography of you, they actually list you as being a father as like your second highlight. Like, and I thought that was pretty cool, because when you read a biography, sometimes it kind of comes down a little bit further, and sometimes even though people may have kids, it's not highlighted, you know, as a highlight. It's kind of like, oh yeah, we know Reese soon has kids, but we're, you know, doing things. But they did list you as a father as your second highlight, and I thought that was pretty amazing. Now, your father was a pianist, correct? Did your father play piano? No.
Not the drummer. Drummer. Yeah, my mother dabbled on keys, but my father was the musician, the main musician, the drummer, and the producer as well.
And you said that you played drums before you could walk. Do you remember what your first drum set was?
Yeah, it was a Muppet Baby drum set.
Oh, you're kidding. Oh. So you had a first baby. Oh my gosh, that is crazy.
Yeah, so I know you're hip to Animal from the Muppets, so I had a Muppet Baby drum set, but once they saw that wasn't going to endure my seriousness, my parents got me a smaller replica of his Ludwig drum set. So he had the big version, I had the small mini version of his, and that was the one that lasted.
I think everyone started out on drums. I mean, that was my first instrument, the drums.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And my dad, just like your dad, I mean, your dad was a real one, man. He was cool, man. But like I said, he played drums also, man. But so I was like you, man, little kid running around there, man, with sticks and beating and playing drums. But of course, eventually I migrated over to the keys, man. But you know, it's just something about those drums that it just attracts all the little boys in church, man.
Yeah.
Most musicians I know start off with the fascination of the drums. It's the most active thing to see, I think. Right. And at those impressionable ages, called a baby, we like to see whoever's the busiest.
Right.
You
right.
kind of gravitate to that.
That's right.
Indirectly. Because like you, Gary, I ended up getting on organ and being the organist, you know. But that's important for, you know, we need to entertain as many instruments as we can. It makes us diversify. And then we could have a better understanding and approach in our playing when we understand everybody's lane, you know?
That's right.
So you posted a Throwback Thursday a couple months ago, and it was you on with Ginuwine, and you were on tour. But in the caption, you said that you did the tour, but you didn't play drums. So I was curious, and I wanted to know, were you just kind of literally just hanging with the guys on the road?
Well, first of all, the whole band was my brothers. We all came from, you know, E.T., G.T. So it was Rap, Nissan, and every of us that grew up together. They were already on that tour. So what was going on, Rapture and I had already moved to New York, and we were living in New York during that tour. So what I was doing is multitasking, because Rap and I, when they weren't playing, we would be doing tracks still. So we would still be producing in studios on tour. So, you know what I mean? Instead of us being separated. So I was on tour with them. The shows, you know, we have more time on our hands off stage than we do on stage.
Right.
So Rap and I was still doing tracks and being busy and still submitting and you know, fulfilling our contractual obligations while we were on tour. So we were killing two birds with one stone.
Gotcha. Okay. Very, very cool. Yeah, definitely. For those who, I think people who haven't toured, they don't realize, like you said, the extra time you're in, or all the time you just set driving, you know? Britt and I used to tour manage, and whenever we come home, people be like, oh, and it was like, yeah, it was cool, we did a lot, but mostly we were in the van sleeping. You know, you're either sleeping or driving, literally, you know? And
every tour bus I've been on, I make that back room a studio. And then so I'm not just out there. And like you said, it's the time that we're not, because our sound checks usually last an hour. Showtime's about an hour and a half. Then we're done.
Yeah.
The rest of that free time and that free space, a lot of people take it for granted. A lot of people are still yet productive while they're gone.
Right.
So I'm that kind of dude. I'm going to have my machines with me on the bus. There's always a group of producers. And then there's those other cats that don't, you know, are not into that, you know, but there's always some extra actor, you know, something to do.
Yeah.
Make wise decisions with that time.
Yes. Right. Oh yeah. So what's your favorite mobile, what are your favorite mobile go-to, your favorite mobile setup? You have a favorite controller?
I think everybody is going to be an advocate of what they first learned on. So I first learned really how to produce on an MPC 2000 XL, Akai. That and kind of on the 3000 too, the Roger Land 3000 NPC as well. But those, I love those. I use it today indirectly, but I still use those. I still use them. I love Logic. I love Pro Tools. I think if you sit down long enough, they all have common denominators of kind of some familiarities, but somebody's gonna always pump one up more than the other because that's the one they use the most. Right. So I can understand all of them, and you give me 10 minutes with any of them, I'll figure it out.
That's right. Production equipment is just like, you know, just like, I guess, just like when it comes to us being an MD, you have your go-to. You have your go-to musicians that you choose, and producers, they have their go-to equipment that they use. You know, it all gets the job done. You know, you can get them all in there, but you just have your go-tos. So, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Definitely. Whatever you the most comfortable on it. Whatever I'm the fastest on, I like to work with that.
So you mentioned that you and Roger were living in New York, and that move to New York was actually after you did the Montel Jordan tour, and Roger was with Missy and Timbaland, correct?
Playa first, really, yeah. More so Playa and a lot of Def Jam artists. We just had all the Def Jam artists on lock, pretty much.
Okay, and that's when you said in an interview that you were playing you guys' stuff for, this was after you guys had just kind of started Keys, and you were playing your stuff for Montel, and Rapture was playing it for Missy and Timbaland, and they both ended up wanting to sign you guys, but you guys decided to go with Timbaland, so that's when you guys moved to New York. But there was something that you said in that interview that really caught me, and it was when you said that once you guys got to New York, that's when Aaliyah heard about you guys, and when you guys had the self-titled project. But you said that you guys were very distinct in making sure that you guys did not sound like Timbaland. That you guys weren't just, you know, wanting to be like, okay, we're gonna, which when you hear a lot of people being signed or, you know, being under a mentor, it's sometimes just that it, I don't know, it's a mock, you know, and they say imitation is the greatest form of flattery. But when you said that, it was like, huh, it really stuck out to me. How important was that to you guys, and what was that process? Was it difficult for you guys? Like, hey, we're not, you know, we don't want to sound, you know, or was it just a natural thing?
It wasn't difficult for us at all. And thank God his mentality is what it is, because he understood that he can cover more ground by having other cats around him that wasn't duplicating what he's already doing. Why have another him? That's kind of a waste of space and resources. So him, he could cover more ground production-wise and diversity-wise. He respected what Raph and I brought production-wise to the table. Whatever we played, we play stuff for each other is night and day. And so, and I understand that process now when any kind of team that I'm building, I always use sports scenarios. You're not gonna have two point guards out there, two centers. You need people that do different things on the team. That's what a team is. Everybody playing a different position, different role. So why would he put a team of a bunch of centers together? You know, he's the center, so he needed a point. So it would behoove him to get some people around that. In case he can't do something, he passes that ball to his teammate. That's the mentality you need to approach a lot of things with.
Right. Okay. Very
good. So that, yeah.
What would you say was the biggest? Did you feel like the move to New York changed you guys' sound and you guys', you know, influence? Because East Coast and West Coast, there too. We talked about the different vibes as far as living, but as far as music, it's a different vibe. Like, it's very, very, very different. Do you feel like that was one thing that made you guys stand out? Was that you guys did kind of take that West Coast Cali vibe over there?
I don't know, even because Rap and I were very so much West Coast. And so, one thing about us even being on the West Coast, we didn't sound like West Coasters. We never did. We never did fit in the category of West Coast producers. We sounded like we had been all over the place. And I think traveling affords you that mentality or that approach a lot. Those experiences help out a lot. Being musicians help out a lot. and the kind of musicians we were. We weren't just church musicians. We love jazz, we love fusion, we love big band, we love rock, we love classical. We could find the appreciation in all of that. And so when you that all together infused, we didn't have a West Coast sound. So but everything does contribute to sound though. So you're absolutely right. Moving to New York gave us another approach, because you can't help but to get, you can't live there and then not be of it after a while. You become New Yorkish, you start walking faster. You can live in California and not walk two blocks, but you move to New York and walk 60 blocks before you know it. It has a way of changing you that you don't even realize initially, but if you give it time and then you look back and reflect, you can see, of course, that contributed to probably a sound. Because when we moved to Australia, we were influenced by the culture and things that were going on over there, the club scene over there, and what made them move over there. And then all of a sudden, you don't realize you're doing it, but you start including and incorporating a little bit of stuff from everywhere. Whether you know, like it or not. But I like the fact that we didn't sound like West Coast dudes.
Yeah.
Thank you, man. We appreciate that. We appreciate your time this evening. It's good to see you and speak to you again after so long, man. Proud of you, man. Definitely proud of you. You know.
Hey, thank you, man. Thank you. That means everything, because you watched me grow up. I appreciate that.
Yes, sir. You know. Hey, definitely, man. Hey, let's we gotta stay in touch, man. I got your number, man.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you, ladies, for having me.
No problem. Thank you. You have a great night.
Hey guys, it's Brittany. So the question of the day, one of the questions of the day was, what does your spouse do that they know just irks your nerves, but they still continue to do? I have a pretty long list, but I can narrow it down to probably when Anthony chews like his mouth. So he already has like a jaw problem that makes his jaw like pop every time he chews. But on top of that, he smacks like really bad, and so you have that popping sound plus the smacking, and those two combined really irks my nerves. Breathing, when he breathes like in a very stressful situation and I just hear him start breathing, that pisses me off. I don't know if it's just me, but I can confirm from other sources that annoys them about their spouse too, when they're upset and they just hear them breathing. Like, that just really irks my nerves. So yeah, that's probably the two things that upsets me the most that he does.
I would say the worst argument I've had with my mom was last year. We switched cars and I drove her car on a trip to Florida. I was gone less than 24 hours. And when I went back to the parking lot, the car was gone. And I had to call her and tell her that her car was stolen at 3:00 in the morning. And it was pretty crazy. It was bad to tell her that the car was stolen, and
so the annoying thing that Joycelyn always does that totally gets under my skin and irritates me is being a backseat driver. Whenever I drive, I can't stand it. It's irritating, it's frustrating. I mean, she is horrible about that, as far as just, but then to counter that, when she drives, she don't want anybody to say anything to her, and she can't drive. I mean, God bless the fact that she can get from point A to point B in one piece, but it's like whenever she's in this passenger seat or driving in the back seat, she feels like she always has to tell you how fast to go, slow down, turn around, put on the brake. It's irritating. And I don't like it. So that's what I'm saying. I don't like it. But she won't stop.
Thank you.
Family, this is Eric Seeks, and you are tuned in to Family Empire.
Hey, it's Brianna Nicole with Family Empire. You're tuned in. Now we are about to get an exclusive interview with Tobias Trevilian. We haven't spoken to Tobias in a while, so we're about to get into an exclusive sit-down, hearing all about what he's been up to since the pandemic and in 2021. Hey, Tobias, how are you today?
I'm doing well, thank you. How's everything?
Everything's going well.
It's good here, man.
Really good to see you. I hope you're having a great holiday season so far.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Okay, awesome. So we have to ask you, because last time we talked to you, the world was a little bit more normal, and COVID was not a thing. So that is the number one question that I want to ask you. How has COVID affected you personally? Because I feel like it's affected everyone differently. You know, it's one pandemic, but it's had a million different results, especially for those who are in the entertainment industry, like yourself. It's changed everything. And I think for those whose lives are slowly starting to get back to normal, for those who are acting or directing, or dealing with, you know, the filming side of the industry, I don't think we're ever gonna get back to normal. I don't think there is a way to get back to normal in that field.
Right. I mean, you know, during this time, you know, I've definitely lost some family members, some close friends, and people that were close to me. So, you know, having that kind of change, having that kind of different dynamic in my life is something that I've been going through, and I'm sure plenty of the people that are listening, and I'm sure you guys have gone through some stuff like that. And that's always a change. I think for me, it's always what I'm trying to practice is normalcy. You know, I'm not a subscriber to, you know, I just try to act and perform like a human being, like to be normal. I think we've kind of gotten away from being normal, that when normalcy comes in front of us, whether we don't know how to even react or how to respond to something like that. So for me, it's always been a just trying to be practice normalcy, just try to be, you know, respectful of people's guidelines and their restrictions and stuff. But at the same time, I try to be normal as possible. That's like my main goal. If I have to go into a store and they want a mask or something like that, fine. If I'm traveling, I've been wearing a mask when I traveled for 20 years. So I have been doing that for 20 years already. Now everyone's catching up to it, but I really try my best just to perform and behave normally, just normal, just to be normal, you know.
Right.
I think I'm very big on, you know, on health and just trying to take care of yourself. And I believe that, you know, all information is very important, but I think you taking care of yourself inside out and being healthy and is a way to combat, you know, any disease or virus or common cold. So, you know, these are the things that I do and I practice all the time as far as eating healthy, exercising, getting a lot of sunlight, you know, my supplements, my, vitamins and things of that nature. And just being proactive and keeping my mind engaged is like my way of just trying to keep healthy mentally, physically, and spiritually. So I think it's important for us to remember who we are and understand that, you know, what's for you is gonna be yours, and nobody's gonna be able to take that away from you. So that's just how I am. That's what I do, you know. When we're on set and stuff like that, you have regulations and rules that we have to abide by as far as masks and things like that. But I'm protected by God. I'm not really, you know, in that fear space as far as just right. operating from, you know, what can happen to me as far as what I can dictate to the world.
Right, exactly. I agree wholeheartedly. And we're going to get into Truth to the Core and all that. But you said something that I want to go back on. You were saying that you've been wearing a mask while traveling for 20 years. And I think that's the biggest thing with the pandemic is I feel like there are like all these people that now have opened their eyes to like cleaning and sanitizing. And I'm like, what, you know what I mean? Like, if you wait, you haven't been doing that.
Right.
So like you said, you've been wearing a mask and there are so many little things that are, like you said, people are making a big deal, but it has been normal for people.
Yeah. And I actually like the mask, especially when you're talking about food and, you know, restaurants and certain things.
Yes.
I think that's really cool.
Yes. I agree. And one thing that has changed, I have a 3-year-old who acts, and one thing that's changed with Set is the people that she works with, like if it's an actor playing her mom or her dad, just the, you know, making sure, hey, can you go wash your hands before you come on set with the baby? Things like that, that is kind of like, we didn't have in place before, you know, it's just kind of like, okay, everyone come on set. And now that they're in place, it's like, oh my gosh, this is actually, can we keep this up? Like after, you know what I mean? After the whole COVID thing, it's like, can we keep doing this? Can we keep being clean? But yeah, I agree. It is just, you know, it's like I said, it's affecting everyone differently and that keeping that sense of norm there for sure. You've actually been really, really busy this year though. You've had several releases. Which is a blessing because there have been a lot of people who haven't been so blessed, you know, during this time. What was the filming process like for you? You feel like this year versus 2019 and the previous years? Do you feel like it was more stressful? Do you feel like it was not? You didn't really have that mental effect. Because it is different when you're, because I know like holding, things like that, holding, even in between crafting, I don't know how it's been up there, but down here, like even crafting and catering on set, that's different. Like you don't go, you know, everything is kind of like individual prepackaged. No, you can't touch it. You know, here's what you want. I'll get it for you. What has it been like in the cities and the states you've been filming in? Because also it's been different in each city and state.
Requirements. Absolutely. Fairly norm. I think people are, you know, protecting themselves, and then we have rules that are set by the union and stuff. So people are just abide by that. Once again, you know, I'm a person that's trying to be normal. You know, I abide by the rules and things of that nature, but anytime I can make light of a situation and interject some humor into what's going on so that we can feel some sort of comfort level as we're trying to figure things out, you know, that's how I operate. I try to, you know, give some sort of balance. You know, I think the type of person that I am, gives off a sort of comforting, or I don't know, but it just gives, I try to balance out all the chaotic stuff by just who I am. And some people who are, you know, in need of that balance, you know, they draw to it. You know, they find some sort of comfort in my presence. They find something, you know, something familiar with it. So that's my objective, is to constantly be normal. Because I'm not, you know, I don't really try to get too caught up in everything else. If there's something that's need to be
not of this world, right.
Yeah. So things have been a little different. We can talk about craft services and stuff like that. And even more like the tests and vaccination and all those things. You know, these are new things that have been implemented into the world. So I think whatever industry you're in, it still affects you. You know, whatever you're doing with your world, with yourself and your world, it still affects you. So, you know, entertainment, day-to-day life, it's something we got to deal with.
Right. And I will agree with what you said. SAG, I do feel like SAG has done a great job with putting the rules into place, protecting the members of the union. And that is something that I will commend them for. Okay, so you just had a release, November 24th, Holiday Chance release. It was a premiere for Holiday Chance.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that movie. Tell us a little bit about your character.
Holiday Chance, it's a Christmas film. It's produced by my dear friend, Nafisa Williams, Manny Haley. The movie's it's a feel-good Christmas movie about two siblings, two sisters who are taking over the family business, which is a multi-entertainment business. Okay. You know, they make films, they do TV, they do all those kind of stuff. And what happens, I don't want to give away too much of the story, but there's an incident that happens within the family dynamic. And basically the two sisters have to figure out how the business can survive. The business was thriving early on in its career, producing films and stuff, and it just hasn't been producing as much money as lately. And my character is the love interest to Nafisa. And I kind of bring a sensibility as far as away from the business, away from the objective of saving the business, and get it back over to the love and the romance of the holidays and support, you know, for Nafisa's character. And, you know, generally that's pretty much like what my character serves. And then there's also a little bit of conflict as far as the love interest portion of us. You know, all relationships just can't be all rosy and
right.
Beautiful. So there's a little riff in there, and then we figure it out. And then we come together as all Christmas movies do.
Right.
Have a big smile and laugh. But this one is traditional. It has great music, great cast. Everybody's gonna love it. It's out right now in theaters. It's on demand. Holiday Chance is the name of it. Starring myself, Mr. Lawson, Richard Lawson, Nafisa Williams, Sharon Leal, Amen Joseph, and Vanessa Bell Calloway. So some of the heavy hitters are in there, and some of my favorites. So it's a good time. It's a good time. I think everyone will enjoy it.
Okay, well, we're looking forward to checking it out. I feel like in the past 3 to 4 years, the influx of Black Christmas movies has really sprung. Not saying that there were not any before. I'm just saying that it has been, you know what I mean? It's been, and it's like, yes, I love to see it. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
It's a great vibe change.
Oh, yeah.
So guys, check out Holiday Chance, premiered on November 24th. Okay, so I want to get into the truth to the core.
Okay.
I don't know if the last time we spoke with you, if you were already in the plant-based lifestyle or if you transitioned since we last spoke to you.
No, I've been plant-based almost 5 years, so.
Okay, awesome. So tell us a little bit about True to the Core. Tell us about your transition. I know that you are actually vegan right now. Mm-hmm. Did you tell viewers about with that transition? Did you transition from, you know, normal to vegetarian to vegan? What was that transition like? And the biggest change you felt?
Oh man, True to the Core is my brand. It's a play on my name from Trevilian. And it's a simple mantra, is always to remain true to yourself, to always follow that inner voice, to always listen to that inner dialogue. And no matter what you do, any choice that you make, that you always check in with yourself first before you make any decision. And it's that basic, simple concept that kind of is our, I guess, mission statement for everything else. Then that spills into the health, that spills into the cooking, that spills into me being plant-based and stuff. Plant-based living and eating veggies and fruits and stuff, it's a subtle way of helping to tune your frequency. You know, when I say tune your frequency, I mean by spiritually being in tune with your thought. Physically to be in command of your process and stuff like that. And this comes from the subtleties of the food and your practice is your spirituality and your physical training and your, you know, mental capacity. All these things play into being true to your core. Plant-based is something that I'm going almost close to 5 years. My leading lady, Erica Ash, I was shooting a TV series called In Content, and she was plant-based and vegan. And I was just admiring her discipline and her craft and her instrument. And I was looking at it, and I was like, man, you know, the next level requires more discipline, you know?
Right.
And I came home, we spent 6 months in Toronto. I came home in January. My dear brother, Ronnie Gilbert, had passed away like 2 months prior, good friend of mine. And I just came home and I was like, it's time to do like just the overall detox, you know? And I went on a Dr. Sebi's cleanse. And just through that process of cleansing my system of the toxins and stuff, I just started feeling enlightened and light in my body and just spiritually rising. So I just kept with it. I just kept going down that line. And it's just been a beautiful process, from physically, from the spiritual aspect of it, and then the mental clarity, and then the manifestation of thought, and the power of the voice. You know, it really is a beautiful thing to watch. And it all comes from, you know, tuning your frequency, staying true to your core, constantly, you know, speaking your truth, regardless of who, what, where, how, and why. And, you know, that's mainly what it is, to always be your authentic self. Always remain in that God presence of your inner voice, which is your superpower.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay, awesome. And you actually, correct me if I'm wrong, but if I was reading your Instagram correctly, you actually make up and sell CMOS through True to the Core, correct?
Oh, yeah. We provide CMOS. I provide like a plant-based one-on-one interactive guide that I help people that are trying to make the transition. Because a lot of people want to go plant-based or are deciding to take that leap. And they're very gung-ho at first, but then they don't know how to sustain themselves.
Right.
So, you know, that's where CMOS comes into play. That's where the plant-based one-on-one lifestyle comes into play. And then also some of the other things and t-shirts and brand, you know, branding items that I have out there as far as True to the Core all come into play.
Okay, awesome. And can you just tell the viewers, I believe it's like 95 minerals.
Oh, yeah. The CMOS has 92 out of 102 minerals for the body. Now, the minerals bring the oxygen to your organs. It's very important that you get these minerals into your body. CMOS is also a natural diuretic. They say your health is in your gut. There should be a hallway, not a storage unit. So the CMOS will help move you. You know what I'm saying? CMOS is also a great anti-inflammatory. So a lot of times we're not even fat as much as we're inflamed from the meat, the processed food, the cheese, the dairy, and the eggs. We have a lot of inflammation in our body that's in our joints, which the CMOS allows and helps pull that out. CMOS is also a natural appetite suppressant. So instead of having a heavy breakfast in the morning, you can have CMOS in the morning, CMOS gel, and that'll suppress your appetite. And then 10, 11 o'clock, you can induce fruits and veggies. And then 1, 2 o'clock, then you can have something a little bit more heavier. So it'll help regulate the body that way. CMOS is great for thyroid, for ladies. CMOS is great for vitality. You want to keep the wood right. You want to keep, you know, ladies, keep everything flowing and everything the way we love it. Get yourself some CMOS. CMOS, I just started using it about eight months ago, is great topically. You put it on your skin. You can put it in your hair. Holds the moisture in your for your hair. It helps soften the skin and it helps tightening up the skin. So CMOS provides multiple uses and it's very, very important for the body's essential use.
Question, Dr. Tobias, I hear when we were talking about the pandemic and everything, and you're talking about how you try to be normal as possible. Do you feel like you can say that because of your plant-based lifestyle? Because I feel like people, you know, even like when it came to like the vaccine, everyone's like, oh, if I go get the vaccine, I'll be okay. But if you're not taking care of your inside body, then honestly, that vaccine can only do so much. So do you feel like your plant-based lifestyle helps you be able to carry on normal during this time?
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, it's a constant, you know, I say tune your frequency. You know, when you start tuning your frequency, meaning that your thought process and your voice actually becomes clear vision on what you want, the universe and certain things start to open up for you. So when you start paying attention to yourself first and to not allow media and certain things to influence you into what they're trying to get you to think and how they want you to behave, you start operating on your terms. You know, like I say, we live in a society, there's rules, there's regulations and things
right.
that you have to abide by. But I don't operate in the sense of someone leading me, I'm leading myself. So there's no, you know, I think, you know, it just gave me more clarity on what's important for myself and what I need to do to best protect myself and my family. And I'm not allowing someone else to tell me what's best for me.
Right.
So let me ask you a question, T. Mm-hmm. So what would your advice be to someone like me, per se, who, you know, am a little older, but still trying to live that vibrant and active lifestyle. However, at the same time, I hear what you're saying, and I'm not mentally ready to actually make that full jump leap in there, but however, willing to take the baby steps. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Because I don't consume the red meat. I don't do anything like that. You know, I try to. Here recently, I just really started eliminating bread and, you know, things like that, dairy products from my diet. However, you know, but if I came to you and you were able to just give me some advice, you know, what would your advice be to me? Because, you know, I every now and then, and I do a good. I like to take the approach of one day at a time.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I say, you know what? I wake up one day and I say, okay, for the next 24 hours, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I'm not going to do. And then, you know, that's as opposed to saying, you know what? I'm just going to stop altogether. Because I feel like mentally, it's easier for me to do it that way and to take on that approach and to just say, just go cold turkey. I just feel like it's a little easier for me just to say, you know, just one day at a time.
Right, right. Well, you know, my grandfather lived to be 99, and he said you could do anything you want in the world just in moderation. And I think if you find balance in yourself or moderation, like my dear brother Al, him and his wife, you know, they'll eat fruits and veggies all week, and then on the weekend they might have a little bit of meat, they might have a little salmon, they might have a little turkey. And, you know, they're staying away from, you know, red meat and certain things of that nature. I think it's about finding balance within, you know, you have the desire already. The spirit is telling you what it needs and wants. It's just there's a I don't want to say a block, but there's basically, when it boils down to it, it's a fight for your soul.
Right.
It's basically a fight for your soul. There's going to be the good side of things. I'm feeling great. I've been eating real life for so good. And I'm feeling great. This is great. I'm elevated. And then you go to the other side. Yeah, even doing good. Turkey burger? You know, like, let's go this way. You know, and it's always going to be that kind of tug of war internally. There's five things that you can do that can dramatically boost your immune system and your outlook for your health. One, get rid of the white salt. The white salt will kill you. Use pink sea salt.
Yeah, the Himalayan salt.
Right. Two, get rid of the white sugar. White sugar is like, it'll take you out. Use either natural sweeteners, dates, agave, go on that. Use natural sweeteners. Get rid of the white processed sugar. Get rid of the white salt. Three, key limes. Key limes are like the body's spark plug. If you go on YouTube and you Google YouTube key lime test, electric test, this is like pure electricity. Not the big limes, the little small key limes.
Okay.
Start inducing those every day, all day. Put it in your water, put it in your salad. Just take them. When me and my boys go to work out, we carry them in our pocket. We halfway through our workout, we bust them in our mouth, squeeze it, energy goes through the roof. Three would be to try to eliminate the dairy, the milk, you know, the cheese, all that stuff. Try to cut back on that dairy and stuff like that. And then five, getting that sea moss in. Those five things would dramatically do amazing things for your body and your system. The energy, and this is a thing where you'll see, like, if you do see some of these things, well, to keep you going and you're trying to figure out, your energy will go through the roof. I'm never tired.
Yeah.
I'm never tired. You know, I get fatigued, but I'm never tired.
Right.
You know, and you're right about that, because, like I say, I did it. It's been about 2 weeks now, man. So the first week, and honestly, I felt it was a drastic change. I really felt more energetic, man. You know, it was like I would have a full day. I would come home, you know, I made it a purpose not to eat anything like after 7 o'clock, anything heavy or anything like that.
Good.
But you know, like I say, I eliminated like the bread and the dairies. But like that first week, I just felt just so much more energized, man.
Absolutely.
In the morning, I wasn't sluggish. I would wake up energized.
Yeah.
Throughout the day, you know, just having that energy and just, of course, hydrating all day and just drinking water. But I feel like I was able to pass the initial test. So I mentally, I think I might be ready to actually make that leap to take.
Yeah. No, come on over.
To the next step.
Come on over. It's you know, the thing is, it's like Reebok and Nike. You know, you gotta understand, when you make the transition, it's not gonna be the same thing.
Yeah. Right.
There's like, look, you spent years being in one way. Now you're over here, and I wanna be over here, but I wanted to be over here like that. You feel me?
Yeah.
I wanna be over here like that.
Right.
It don't work that way. It don't work that way. This is a lifestyle. This is a lifestyle change. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's a beautiful thing. The one thing I love about veggie life, and when you start making alkaline smoothies and some of these things and desserts, I can eat like this all day long. I'll be fine.
Yeah.
I can eat it. I can eat like that on the hour, every hour, all day.
Yep.
I'll be fine, because it's veggies. And that spark and that electric feel that you're feeling, mm-hmm. is that's who we are. We're electricity, we're sunbeams, we're grounded, we are the planet. So that's the charge that you're supposed to feel. And the more and more you feel that and you tune that frequency, the higher elevation that you will rise. And the more and more you rise that way and open up this third eye and that pineal, your conscious thought will manifest.
Well, thank you so much, guys, for sitting down and speaking with us
today. Thank you, Family Empire. I love this.
You guys, with all of Tobias's links to his website, Teaching the Core, his personal Instagram, and where you guys can be sure to stay tuned for all of his new projects, as well as stream his current projects that are available for replay. Tobias, we wish you an incredibly blessed and happy holiday season.
Thank you so much.
2021, and we will see you in 2022.
Absolutely. Have a great blessed day, new year. And thank you.
You
too, man.
Bear with me.
Like,
absolutely. Absolutely.
Hey, guys. We hope you're enjoying the show so far, but now it's time for Cocktails with B. Okay, so just putting this out there, Family Empire encourages you to drink responsibly, no underage drinking, 21 and up, please. So I am not a professional mixologist, bartender, or anything like that, but I will say this. At the family functions, I'm the one that everyone asks to make them a little drunky drink. So I'm going to show you guys how to make a nice little drink, just a few things that I have at home. Simple. I am not a dark liquor type of girl, so most of the drinks that I'm going to be making are going to be made with things like vodka, tequila, rum, things like that. So, got my little mixy thing here. Got some ice, and I'm going to put my ice in there. Today we are going to use some Milo's lemonade. I really like Milo's. Listen, I do not measure. I kind of just go with what my heart desires and kind of eye it out. So that's what we're doing today. Today we're reaching for our 1800 tequila. And we are going to use that. I'm gonna put some of this in here. Again, I don't measure. So
I'm gonna add that, and then we are going to go in with a nice fruit punch. Y'all, today I'm using Hawaiian punch, but you can use whatever you want to use. Add that in there. And then I'm going to add, this is the name of the brand is called Skinny Syrups. This isn't the one I'm using, but it's the one I'm using is the raspberry lemonade one. It's called Skinny Syrups. You can get them at like TJ Maxx, Marshall's, things like that. I'm just gonna add some of that in there. And then we are gonna shake this bad boy up. Again, like I said, super simple. Sorry guys, there's something in my sugar. Super simple with ingredients you probably have laying around the house. And then shake, 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 shake. I like really fruity drinks, so a lot of drinks I'm making are gonna be fruity. And then I have my straw here. And cheers. Let's give it a taste test. Good. Thanks guys for tuning in.
I'm a superhero, I got superpowers. I can see the future, we gon' live forever. X-ray vision, I see through my villains, yeah. I feel like I can fly, jump straight out the window. Jump, yeah. 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 Baby, from the rooftops, this ugly city looks so pretty, I think I just fell in love.